हेलो, दिस इज़ डॉक्टर विनीता, एमपीटी ऑर्थो, एंड वी कंटिन्यू द टॉपिक शोल्डर जॉइंट एंड शोल्डर जॉइंट कंडीशंस। इन शोल्डर जॉइंट लास्ट वीडियो वी लर्न समथिंग अबाउट रोटेटर कफ टेंडिनाइटिस। टुडे वी लर्न रोटेटर कफ टेंडिनाइटिस इन द ओवरहेड एथलीट्स। Like the athlete, those activities in which they require overhead movements. Like we classify the overhead movement that require repetitive motion with the arm in at least 90 degree of forward flexion or abduction, or a combination of both. Athlete like who participated in swimming, tennis, or throwing sports experience these type of repetitive trauma to the shoulder joint. Result are prone to shoulder disorders. The frequency of injuries related to the athlete, like age of the athlete and the level of competition. Okay, these patients present a significant diagnostic and treatment challenge to the physician. They usually demonstrate a degree of hyperlaxity of the GH joint and resulting from an increased anterior laxity of their shoulder capsule, which is required to perform this overhead motion, as well as compensatory tightening of the posterior capsule. Symptom-free function in setting of substantial GH joint laxity or looseness is accomplished by the proper development of dynamic stabilizer crossing the GH joint. Today, our topic on this, and we study the patterns. Okay, how throwing motion happen, like if posterior capsule tightness, which manifests as a loss of internal rotation, is often present in overhead thrower and may lead to anterior superior humeral head translation, further contributing to irritation of the shoulder joint. Now we just study the six stages of biomechanics of throwing motion. First stage is wind up. In wind up stage serve as the preparatory phase. This is the preparatory phase, include body rotation and when the ball leaves the non-dominating hand, ball leaves the non-dominating hand, then next phase is the early cocking phase. In early cocking phase, this phase is wind up phase. Next is early cocking. As the ball is released from the glove hand and shoulder abduction away from the body and rotate. The body start moving forward, generating momentum. Early cocking terminate as the forward foot contact to the ground. Okay. In next late cocking phase. In late cocking phase, as the body rapidly moves forward, The dominating shoulder achieve maximal abduction, and external rotation. Significant torque and force are placed on the shoulder wrist at this extreme range of motion. Next, we proceed to the acceleration phase. Begin with further forward body motion, then internal rotation of the humerus leading to an internal rotation of throwing arm. Acceleration ends with the ball release. Follow through phase. Complete the remaining 70% of time required to dissipate the excessive kinetic energy. All major muscle group must eccentrically contract to accomplish this result. Follow through and when all motion is completed. These are the 6 phases of throwing activity. Now we start how the athlete get any trauma or any pain and how we find out that. Athlete who experience pain in late coking phase. In the late coking phase, usually localize the symptom to the anterior shoulder aspect of their, and the position of the arm during late coking phase is maximal abduction and external rotation, okay, which challenge the anterior stability of the GH joint. Pain during this stage can be result of anterior instability or from the rotator cuff owing to secondary impingement related to anterior instability. This pain result into anterior instability. Okay, discomfort during the late coking and early acceleration stage can be experienced posteriorly and may be secondary to the irritation of the posterior capsule of rotator cuff. It tries to balance out the increased anterior laxity. Another potential cause is trauma to the posterior superior glenoid labrum. Posterior superior glenoid labrum and associated articular surfaces of rotator cuff related to hyperabduction and rotation that occur during overhead shots. This condition has been labeled internal impingement and may be another consequence of subtle increase in anterior GH joint laxity. Then these patients are diagnostic challenge to the physician. A considerable amount of information can be obtained from history. It is important to identify the specific throwing phase associated with the onset of symptom. If you have any athlete patient or throwing patient with the shoulder rotator cuff tendonitis, when you are taking history of that patient, you should have identify the specific throwing phase which is associated with the onset of symptom. First, the localization of pain is important. Well documentation, recent changes in the athletic training routine include both general condition, throwing regimen, all these things. On physical examination, one need to examine for the shoulder instability, posterior capsule tightness, posterior capsule tightness, primary impingement, and rotator cuff tendinitis. Physical examination indicative of a rotator cuff tendinitis include tenderness and possibly weakness with registered external rotation or abduction in the scapular plane. Pain with resistance is known as tendon sign and at minimum represents inflammation of the cuff tendons. Resolution of the symptom and recovery of strength after injection of lidocaine in the subacromial space strongly suggest cuff tendinitis rather than a cuff tear. Then rotator cuff tendinitis can lead to secondary type impingement and also make a primary impingement syndrome more symptomatic. Then we proceed to the rehabilitation program for this. In rehabilitation program for pitchers, position players, tennis players, golfers are included in the internal throwing section. These programs should be implemented for all patients returning to their sport after a period of inactivity. Sport-specific rehabilitation program to be successful, the entire body must be re-educated in a step-wise fashion to perform the various activity related to the sports. Thrower rehab regime includes self-stretching techniques, changes in tightness of the capsule, off-season adherence or rotator cuff scapulothoracic and shoulder girdle strengthening with the thrower strength program, excellent conditioning of the entire athlete, warm-up and cool-down period with practice and games, avoidance of overuse throwing while fatigue, use of throwing program. Okay, we start with this is the classification system. Like if shoulder patient, functioning athlete, older population or younger population, this is age-wise factor. Then instability group, no instability, group IB, instability, group second, instability, third, fourth, we divided in groups. Then outside, inside impingement or no impingement, inside impingement. Then we further classify these according to the location of impingement. We start with the stretching part. This stretching is for the inferior capsular stretch. In this position, hold the involved arm overhead with the elbow bent and the arm straight ahead. Using the uninvolved arm, stretch the arm further overhead. When a stretching sensation is felt, hold for 5 seconds and then repeat. 5 sec, hold, then repeat. Next, posterior capsule stretch. With the uninvolved arm, grasp the elbow of the involved arm. Pull the involved arm across the chest, the back of the involved shoulder, hold at the end point 5 seconds, then repeat. This is very important in thrower because of the tight posterior capsule. Next is the anterior capsular stretch. Standing in a doorway, the patient hold with the elbow straight and the shoulder abduct to 90 degree, shoulder abduction 90 degree, elbow straight, external rotation. Okay, walk through the doorway until a stretch is felt at the front of the shoulder. Hold for 5 seconds and then repeat. Avoid this stretch in patient with general ligamentous laxity or multidirectional instability. Next, we move to the pectoralis minor stretch. In pectoralis minor stretch, lie on the back, pushing the shoulder towards the ceiling, upside, and with the partner giving resistance, relax and have the partner stretch shoulder down. Hold the stretch for 5 seconds. Then pectoralis major stretch. Stand facing a corner. Okay. Position one arm on each side of the corner with the arm approximately 90 degree away from side and forearm resting on the wall. Lean forward onto the corner until a stretch is felt front of the shoulder. Hold for 5 seconds and repeat. Then we proceed to the next session, which is bicep stretch. In this, sit with the elbow extended, okay, and resting on the leg with the unlowered arm, pushing on the forearm. Straighten the elbow, hold the stretch for 5 seconds. Then we proceed to the next, which is diagonal pattern D2 extension. In this, grip the tubing handle and you saw one tube is in market for these type of stretches. Tubing handle and overhead and out to the side with the hand on the involved arm. Pull the tubing down and across the body to the opposite side of the leg. This pattern. During the motion, lead the thumb, performs like 10 sets, 5 repetition, 10 times daily, according to the condition. Diagonal pattern D2 flexion. Grip the tubing handle in the hand, involved arm, beginning with the 45 degree. Out from the side, palm facing backward. After turning the palm forward, flex the elbow. Bring the arm up over the uninvolved shoulder. Turn the palm down. Reverse to take the arm to the starting position. And this exercise perform in a controlled manner. And the repetition and the sets to be according to the patient condition. Next, we start with the dumbbell exercise for deltoid and supraspinatus. Dumbbell exercise for deltoid and supraspinatus deltoid strengthening. Stand with arm at the side with the elbow straight. And the palm against the side. Raises the arm to the side, palm down until the arm reaches 90 degree. This is also according to patient condition. Then we proceed to the supraspinatus strengthening. Stand with elbow straight and thumb up. Raise the arm shoulder level at a 30 degree angle in front of the body. Do not go above shoulder height. Hold for 2 seconds. Low slowly, then we lower down slowly. All these exercises, you have to instruct the patient that all these stretches should be sustained, slow and sustained. Okay, then we proceed to the next exercise, which is prone shoulder abduction और रोम्बॉइड्स डायगोनल पैटर्न डी टू फ्लेक्शन सेम पेशेंट स्टार्ट विद द शोल्डर अबडक्शन ओके दिस इज एंटी ग्रेविटी विद द इनवॉल्व हैंड ग्रिप द ट्यूबिंग हैंड अक्रॉस द बॉडी अगेंस्ट द थाई ऑफ द अपोजिट लेग स्टार्टिंग विद द पाम डाउन रोटेट द पाम अप टू बिगिन एंड फ्लैक्स द एल्बो देन फ्लैक्स द एल्बो आर्म अप ओवर द इनवॉल्व शोल्डर टू टेक द आर्म स्टार्टिंग पोजिशन देन वी मूव टू द नेक्स्ट इन प्रोन लाइन देन वी मूव टू द इंटरनल अबडक्शन पोजिशन इंटरनल रोटेशन एट 90 डिग्री अबडक्शन देन एक्सटर्नल रोटेशन देन वी स्टार्ट द बाइसेप स्ट्रेंथनिंग इन बाइसेप स्ट्रेंथनिंग स्टैंड विद वन एंड ऑफ द ट्यूबिंग सिक्योरली इन्वॉल्व हैंड एंड अपोजिट एंड अंडर द फुट of the involved side controlling tension assist with the opposite hand flexing the arm full range of motion return to the starting position with slow 5 count repeat 3 to 5 sets of 10 repetition then we start to the dumbbell exercises for triceps and wrist extensors wrist flexion wrist extension Support the forearm on a table with the hand off the edge, the palm facing upward. Hold a weight or hammer in involved hand and lower it as far as possible. Then curl it up as high as possible. Hold for 2 count, perform. And you will give sets and repetition according to the patient condition. Then in wrist extension position, support the forearm on the table with the hand off the edge, the palm facing downward. Hold a weight or hammer in the involved hand and lower it as far as possible and curl it up. Then forearm pronation, support the forearm on the table with the wrist in neutral position. Hold a weight or hammer in normal hammering position. And roll the wrist, bring the hammer into pronation as far as possible. Hold for 2 count. Then forearm supination. Support the forearm on a table with the wrist in neutral position. Hold a weight or hammer in a normal hammering position. And roll the wrist, bringing the hammer into full supination. Hold for 2 counts. Then we start the stratus anterior strengthening. Start with a push up into the wall, gradually progress to the tabletop and eventually to the floor as tolerable and according to the patient conditions. Then we press up. Sit on the chair or table and place both hands firmly on the sides of the chair or table, palm down and finger pointed outward. Hands should be placed as far apart as the width of the shoulder. Slowly push downward, throw the hands to elevate the body. Hold the elevated position for 2 seconds. Repetition according to the patient. Then rowing on the we lie on the stomach or in prone line position with the involved arm hanging over the side of the table, dumbbell in the hand, the elbow straight, slow raise the arm, bending the elbow and bring the dumbbell as high as possible and hold it at the top for 2 seconds, then slowly low down and repeat this and repetition always should be according to the patient condition because in starting we learn all these factors that if we are using the affected arm more repeatedly and patient feel pain, then we harm the patient and we worse the condition, and it will lead to the irritation of the rotator cuff. So these are the stretchings, and today's session is all over the athletic rotator cuff tendonitis. I hope you enjoy the study and you learn some good things, and you enhancing your knowledge with this YouTube channel. And please suggest me or comment me below my video, or subscribe my video and like my video. And if you want something new, or you want some other topics which you want to learn, and then please comment below. And thank you so much for supporting me, or thank you so much the viewer who view my video, and thank you so much.